Merry Christmas. Yeah. Welcome to Peace. Welcome to your Lord's house. It's so great to have you here this evening for our candlelight service. We're going to begin our service shortly. As we prepare to begin, I just want to point out a couple of things. It's a candlelight service, so if you have not received a candle yet, there are plenty in the back. Make sure you get a candle for singing Silent Night by candlelight a little bit later. Make sure you also have a service folder if you'd like to follow along that way. The service will also be on the screen as well, so you can follow along if that's easier too. Before we begin, we're going to have a little bit more music. During that time, maybe what I'd have you do is to take out your bulletin, and if you wouldn't mind, there's a QR code in there in the first very first page, and what that is a Connect card. And a Connect card is just exactly what it sounds like, an opportunity for us to be able to connect with you, to give thanks that you're here today, because we are so happy that you're here. Maybe an opportunity, if you need some service, an opportunity for me to serve you further. And then also, what we'd love to do is follow up with you and give you a kind of a thank you gift for coming tonight. So if you just have a few minutes and can do that, that'd be great. So, all right, Merry Christmas, and we'll begin shortly.
Every year at this time, we jump into the middle of a story that's been told for hundreds of years.
It's a story of cities decorating their streets and their sidewalks. It's a story of trees and ornaments and fireplaces, of gifts and wrapping paper and ribbons. There's expectation and wonder and hope that all of this is going to bring joy. But for true joy, we have to go back to the simple beginning of it all. It starts in a manger, with a baby and an angel and an announcement of divine promise of rescue and peace now fulfilled. It's about a child who will bring light into darkness, joy into despair, revealing the God who will redeem and save all. A God who is leaving the glory of heaven to pursue the glory of a cross. A God who is becoming flesh and blood and skin. A God who is loving and offering people a pathway back into the relationship for which they were created. It's too rich to comprehend and too beautiful to dismiss. This is Christmas. This is the dawn of joy. And it all starts here. Thank you. Again, welcome to our worship this evening, this Christmas Eve. So happy you're here. As you can see, the theme of our worship tonight is Joy Has Dawned. There are so many things that we do that bring us joy at Christmas, but in a couple of days, they kind of fade away, don't they? And yet, when we clear all the extra away and get back to the simple message of what started it all, we can have a joy that lasts for all eternity. That's going to be the theme, and God willing, that's going to be the encouragement from tonight's worship. I invite you to stand as we join in saying together, saying back and forth, the Psalm of Joy. Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad.
Let the sea resound, and all that is in it.
Let the fields be jubilant, and everything in them. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord, for he comes.
Proclaim his salvation day after day.
We pray. O loving God, you once caused this holy night to shine with the brightness of the true light. Turn our thoughts toward Bethlehem and the Christ child. May the words of Scripture we hear tonight remind us again that the old story is ever so new. May the carols we sing tonight fill us again with the joy of our Savior's birth. May the candles we see tonight symbolize for us your Son as the light of the world. May all who have known that light on earth come to the full measure of its joys in heaven. Be near us, O Lord, in our worship this night and in our lives always. Amen. You may be seated. We turn to our first reading. It's a reading from Isaiah chapter 9. It's a promise from God to those who are walking in darkness, not because the sun had set, but because of the darkness of this world. We've all experienced that darkness, whether it was from someone else, from the world around us, or even the darkness within us. Jesus is the light that dawns on us and gives us life. Pay attention, close attention to the names of this Savior who was born for us. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The word of the Lord. And I would invite children to come forward if you're comfortable, and we'll just kind of gather up here on this platform and have a children's message just for you. Try this. Thank you so much for coming up here. Merry Christmas. Well, thank you. Yeah, it is a Merry Christmas. Merry means happy, joyful, and we're going to see why Christmas is so joyful. I am curious if any of you made a Christmas list, a list of things, of presents that you wanted. Did anybody make a Christmas list? Is that a thing anymore? No? Can we make a Christmas list right now? Like, what if you could put on a list something that you would want to find underneath a Christmas tree? What would be on the list? I'll write it down. Legos, okay. Legos on the list. How about anybody else want to put? What is it? LOL Dow. Yes, I know what those are. LOL Dow. Anybody else? An egg that can turn into a dragon? Wow, I'm going to put dragon egg. That sounds really cool. Anybody else? Is there something you would want to put on the list?
No.
Mickey? That's a great one too. Good job. Okay, we've got a good Christmas list. Wouldn't that be great to find all those presents underneath the Christmas tree? Everything you ever wanted? Let me make another list now. So this is the list that you guys want. What if tomorrow you get socks? What if tomorrow you get a spoon? Cool, huh? What if tomorrow you want a new spoon? All right. It's going to be a happy day, I tell you. Yeah. Sometimes we have things that we want, and then there's other things that maybe we don't always think we want, but things that we need, right? Sometimes you ever get Christmas presents that are you're happy about, but you didn't necessarily want them, but you need them? Yeah, you want the ones that you want, right? Yeah. Oh, wow, that's a lot. Ooh. So when you think about Christmas presents, there's all different kinds, aren't there? And it's if we just get these kinds of things, it's easy to be disappointed, right? I really wanted Legos. I really wanted that Mickey or the Dragon's Egg or the LOL doll, but I got socks. Socks are good, right? We all got to wear them. What if, and a new spoon, right? What if you get a gift that's both? You really super want it. It makes you super happy, and you really, really need it. Wouldn't that be the best gift ever?
Yeah.
That's why we're here tonight. Because when we look at the gift that God gives us at Christmas, what we see is a little baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger like this, a feeding trough, a feeding box. And when we first look at it, it doesn't look like what we would want for Christmas, does it? A baby in a... But baby Jesus is exactly what we need and ends up what we want. Why? Because Jesus was born not to just be a cute little baby, but so that he can be your Savior. In other words, he was born to show you how much he loves you. He wanted to take all the bad things we do and get rid of them so that they don't bother us anymore, so that God doesn't see them anymore. He wanted to come to earth so that one day we can be with him forever in heaven. And so when you first look at the manger, it might be like, oh, kind of looks like socks. It doesn't look like much, right? Until you remember why Jesus came. So tonight, and then during Christmas, I want you to remember that Jesus gives you exactly what you need. All of his love, yeah. All of his love, all of his forgiveness, and eternal life in heaven. And so it ends up that what you need makes you super happy too, doesn't it? Yeah, so Jesus is the best Christmas present ever. Thank you so much for coming up here. Thanks for making a list with me. You can go back to your chairs. We continue with another reading. This reading comes from 1 John chapter 4. And this is really the meaning of Christmas that we just shared with the children, that God shares with his children of all ages, that his true love is him not making us come to him, but him coming to us and doing everything we couldn't possibly do for ourselves so that we can have heaven. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. the word of the Lord. We continue with our next song, talking about how God's love has come. Unto us a child is born, unto us God's Son is given. His name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Amen. I remember one Christmas, things just felt a little off for me. And I couldn't put my finger on it right away. On the outside, everything looked fine. The stockings had been hung and all filled. That was good. I looked on the tree, and candy canes had been hung on the limbs, one of my favorite childhood traditions. As Mom and Dad passed out the presents, they had the same beaming smiles. Everything looked pretty good. And yet, as I unwrapped socks and gloves, and a book, that's when things felt a little off for me. Now, I know, I was trying not to be greedy, I was trying not to be selfish, but at the same time, I did have some expectations, I had some wants, I had, for goodness sakes, I had a list, okay? And gloves and socks and a book that is not on the list. It's not that I wasn't thankful for them. It's just that, I'm going to be honest with you, it's disappointing to want something, to expect something, to be waiting for something, and then you don't see it. And so that's kind of when it hit me. Everything else looked just fine on the outside for Christmas, but by the time that the wrapping paper was strewn all over the living room floor, that's when I knew, yeah, something's a little off. But then I heard the most amazing words. Wait a minute. There's one more present. I thought, there's no way. I scoured the tree. I even looked inside the branches. There's nothing there. But there it was, coming out from behind the curtains, a surprise gift, an unexpected gift, a gift that was too big to be wrapped and placed under the tree. And to be honest, a gift that was way too wonderful for me to even consider putting on my list. And as soon as I heard those words, there's one more present, that's when I knew things aren't off. Things are actually just going to be better than I ever expected. That's what we're going to look at for a few minutes as we consider the words of the Christmas gospel, the Christmas history, that sometimes a present is too wonderful to imagine, and it's better than you could have ever expected. Now, we're going to read Luke chapter 2 in its entire, at least 1 through 20, in its entirety after the message. I'm just going to focus on a few verses during the message today. I suppose people living a couple thousand years ago, they didn't experience Christmas the way we do, obviously, right? They didn't have the trees and the lights and the wrapping paper and all that, but that doesn't mean that they didn't have expectations and wants and even a list. They had a list of Christmas wants, and the list was actually printed out for them in God's Word. The prophets of old had given them their list of what they wanted and what they could expect out of their Savior. And yet, as you look at the actual history, did their list match what they actually got? Let's just take a look at a few of the people that actually experienced the first Christmas. Let's take a look at Joseph, first of all. So Joseph was just like anybody else living at his time. He had these expectations of Christmas, in other words, an expectations of what he wanted out of the deliverer that God promised. And what he wanted was what we heard in one of the lessons, that this Savior from God would come and shatter oppression. They were under foreign oppression for so long, and he was wanting it to be done so he could just experience a little peace in his life. But how did it happen? In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken. And so Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. And he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. Look at this in a different light. So much for shattering oppression, right? The oppressive foreign government, the leader of that oppressive foreign government, actually issued this decree that made him take a journey that he couldn't afford. And then so much for peace, too, because as he traveled on this journey, he's making this journey with his wife, who was carrying a child that wasn't his, and he was still grappling with all of that. So on the first Christmas, don't you think things were a little off for Joseph? I'm sure that's what he felt. Let's take a look at another character, Mary. Mary had hopes. She had expectations. I think they were pretty simple. The hope of a warm light of a relative's home to stay in when they got to Bethlehem. And then she knew that the time was coming for the baby to be born, and so she had these hopes that were given to her by the angel of God that her baby would be the Almighty God. That's what she expected, and yet look at how it happened. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths, placed him in a manger. There's no guest room available for them. So much for light and warmth. The only place she had to labor was a cold place where the animals were, and dark. So much for the Almighty. The mightiest place she could find was a feeding trough. For Mary, with all of her expectations, don't you think things seemed a little off for her? Let's take a look at one more group, the shepherds. Shepherds had expectations. They were closely related to Joseph's, that a deliverer would come and enlarge the nation. Maybe, just maybe, they could hope to have their own land sometime, make a better living for themselves. But how did it really happen? The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people." Here we go. A baby wrapped in cloths, laying in a manger. The only thing that changed for them because of this good news was their a little bit of scenery from where sheep were eating to where cows were eating. Do you think things seemed a little off for the shepherds? I think so. I realize this isn't the way we usually read the Christmas gospel, right? I'm not trying to ruin anybody's Christmas here, but these are real people. They're no different from you, having these all these expectations and then experiencing how it really happened. I think we have these nativity scenes where we picture these beaming, glowing faces. But I've got to believe that the real face was a little confused. Bethlehem? A baby? A manger? This is what this has all been about for thousands of years? Things had to feel a little off. That brings me to you. What's your story? Do you have one of those Christmas stories? Or maybe there was a year, or maybe more than one year, where things seemed a little off for you? Come on, it's okay. You can be candid. It doesn't matter how young you are. It doesn't matter how old you are. We all have this list of what we hope to get out of Christmas. And it's all varied, right? Maybe it is that perfect present. Maybe it's the Pinterest-worthy cookies in the house perfectly decorated. Maybe it's finally having everybody together at the table for once, enjoying a meal. Maybe it's bigger than that. Maybe it's health for your family. Maybe it's sharing with people in need. Maybe it's just a sense of peace and real joy and love. Those are the things that make Christmas so beautiful. Those are good things to have on your list. But every year, do you get to that point where you find yourself kind of searching for more? You had all these wants, and it's like me when I was a kid, looking under the tree and just not finding exactly what you were looking for. It's not that you're ungrateful for the good things you have. That's not what I'm saying. It's just that it's easy to come to Christmas and feel like there should be more. Like, not everything lived up to what you had hoped it would be. Like, something's just a little off, right? And maybe that's why you're here tonight. And can I just say, I'm just so happy you are here. This is awesome to be here in God's house with you. Thank you for coming tonight. You got all dressed up. You're here wishing everybody a Merry Christmas. You're going to hold the candles. You're going to sing the songs. You're going to hear the Gospel of Luke once again. And in that all, you're looking for that thing, that expectation. And what does God say to you? Well, it's the same thing. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. Here's a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger. Even as I say that, doesn't the Christmas gospel even become confusing for all of us? Not that we don't appreciate it. It's just, it's not always everything that we see on TV. It's not like the Hallmark movies where everything is picture perfect. A baby lying in a manger is not this wonderful Instagram post. It's not as shiny like the things underneath your Christmas tree. And to be honest, a baby lying in a manger is probably not like the thing on your list. But as you look at the baby wrapped and lying in a manger, here's what I want you to think about. Has it ever occurred to you that your Christmas needs go beyond anything you could ever put on a list? Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever considered that maybe you want your Christmas planning to be absolutely perfect because you're frustrated with all the things in your life that are not perfect, including sometimes the way you live toward God and each other, no matter how hard you try? Have you ever considered that you might be hoping for that special family bonding moment this Christmas because deep down you know there's another relationship that needs bonding? Your relationship with the creator of the universe, with God. Have you ever considered that maybe you're waiting for that one present that's everything you've ever wanted because nothing up to this point has ever given you joy and satisfaction that lasts? It always fades into disappointment, doesn't it? That's why God doesn't just say there's a baby lying in a manger. That's why he comes to you and he says, wait, don't give up yet. There's one more present for you. And it's this. A Savior has been born to you. I get it. Lying in a manger, it's maybe not what you expect. But I'll tell you this, wrapped in cloths, it is everything that you need. I really believe there's a reason why we're told to notice the fact that this baby is wrapped. This baby is wrapped so that he can meet every one of your Christmas needs. Not the need for the perfect present or the perfect decorations or anything else. The needs that I just talked about that need to be rescued from imperfection, to be rescued from an imperfect relationship with God, to be rescued from sin and guilt and all of its punishment, to be rescued from death, and even to be rescued from that never-ending cycle of disappointment. And so this last gift, this surprise, unexpected gift that God gives you is wrapped from birth on. Think about it. He's wrapped, not just in cloths, but wrapped in your flesh so that he can take your place. He's wrapped in your guilt so that he can take your punishment and you don't have to. He's wrapped, I think, pointing ahead to a time when he'd be taken down from a cross, wrapped in burial linens to take your death. And he's wrapped in humility so that one day you can be wrapped in glory. Are you starting to see it? This baby was born so that you could have everything you could have ever expected out of Christmas, but thought was too wonderful or too impossible to ask for. This baby was born to give you perfection. This baby was born to restore peace to your relationship with God. This baby was born to take away every sin, all of your guilt, all the punishment that goes with it. This baby was born to defeat death. And this baby was born so that you can have joy and satisfaction that lasts forever. This baby was born to save you. So this is where this all leads. I pray that every one of you has just a wonderful Christmas. I pray that you enjoy all of your family traditions, that you get wonderful gifts, that this Christmas you experience loving and being loved. I pray that it's almost as perfect as you could ever imagine. But later, like probably in a day or two, when everything feels like it's just over, and when you're trying to hide the disappointment behind a big Christmas smile, that's when I want you to pause. And that's when I really want you to think back to tonight and to God's words. Maybe even open your Bibles to Luke 2 again. Even if it's after Christmas, it's okay. And in the middle of that disappointment, if you listen closely to God's words, you're going to hear your loving God say to you, wait a minute, it's not over. There's one more present for you. This baby was born to save you, not just on December 25, but every day from now to eternity. And at that moment, that's when you'll realize, oh, things aren't off. Actually, Christmas is just way better than I could have ever expected. Amen. I don't know. There we go. This evening, I invite you to stand as we offer our prayers to our God. Gracious God, what a privilege to be in your house and be reminded of your great love once again. It is an amazing miracle to think that the God of the universe would come down to take our place, to take on our flesh, to take on our guilt, to take on our sin, even our death, all to save us from those things. Lord, help us not to just gaze at the manger and think of a cute little baby, but help us to see our Savior, and not just tonight, not just tomorrow, But when real life happens, when things start to disappoint us, when things start to overwhelm us, take us back to what the manger is all about as it leads to the cross and to the empty tomb and eventually to heaven. Lord, help us to see that Christmas is better than we could have ever expected because at Christmas we have a Savior. Lord, fill us with that joy tonight. Fill us with that joy every day and help that joy to overflow so that many more can share in that wonderful joy of Christmas all year long. We pray this in the name of Jesus, and in his name we continue to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. We continue now with the reading of the Christmas Gospel. Recorded in Luke chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. We continue with the Christmas Gospel in Luke 2. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. The Gospel of our Lord. We'll continue with the candlelight portion. So ushers will come down the aisles and will light the candle of the first person on each aisle. Just a good reminder that only tip an unlit candle. So if your candle's already lighted, don't tip it, because the lit candle will drip. So only tip unlit candles. Thank you. Almighty God, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that as we have known on earth the wonder of that light, we may also behold him in all glory in the life to come. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May you extinguish your candles. Before our last song, I just want to welcome everybody again and just say thank you for being here. You could be many places tonight, but you chose to be here, and we appreciate that, and we pray that you have been blessed and that God has filled you with peace and God has filled you with much joy with the simple message of a Savior born just for you. Our final song will be Sing Joy. It'll be some of the familiar Christmas carols. You're welcome to join in on the parts that are in bold if you're following along in the service folder, or just note it'll be the final two verses if you're singing along on the screen. God's blessings to you, and Merry Christmas.